Friends, today I am going to speak to you about the silk route of the sea, which flourished from the 1st century BC to the 3rd century AD in its core period of operations. Now, what was the silk route of the sea? If you imagine the Indian Ocean and the Red Sea to the west, the story really begins with the Roman conquest of Egypt in 30 BC, through which the Romans got access to the Egyptian Red Sea ports, and they refurbished these ports and initiated sea trade operations down the Red Sea through the Gulf of Aden towards India and also other parts of the Indian Ocean like the Persian Gulf, the East African coast, the Bay of Bengal up to the Ganges Delta and perhaps also to Southeast Asia. Now, this event between the trade, sea trade between the Roman Empire and India, also known as Indo-Roman sea trade, was important, but it was still a critical subset of the larger exchange networks stretching far beyond the Bay of Bengal, known as the Silk Route of the Sea, which extended not only to Southeast Asia, but from Southeast Asia to Southern China and into the Far East up to China and Japan. And on the West, they took into account a large part of the Mediterranean itself. This entire exchange network, which was connected to each other, several exchange networks were connected to each other, is what we would call the Silk Route of the Sea. Now, before we begin the journey, we should also distinguish this from the Silk Route of the Land, which was an earlier operation. And if you imagine the Eastern Mediterranean and the land routes passing through Syria, Iraq, Iran into Afghanistan and thence towards China into Central Asia and also down to the warm water ports of the Arabian Gulf, this silk route of the land was often mired in conflicts, especially between the Romans and the Parthians in the area of the Euphrates and Tigris rivers. And therefore, when the Romans conquer Egypt in 30 BC and get access to the Red Sea coast, the Western world actually, you know, creates an alternative maritime route to India, and this was what was important. And this route, at least the one between Egypt and India, is graphically described in a 1st century AD sea guide written by anonymous Greek sailor, and it's called the Periplus Maris Erythrae. We will call it the Periplus, and we will actually be drawing from the Periplus to sort of point out the several harbors which have been described in it, and this will be used, references to the Periplus will be used in the journey that we are about to take through maps and pictures along the Silk Route of the Sea that will just follow. So friends, let us, you know, go ahead with this journey. Okay, so this map shows you the general canvas of the Silk Route of the Sea, which is most of the Indian Ocean and of course the adjacent areas of the Far East up to Japan, which are connected to Indian Ocean and Southern Chinese network, so we call it the Indo-Pacific connect. And here above the Red Sea, the Mediterranean Sea, which is connected to the Indian Ocean networks, and we will call it the Indo-Mediterranean connect. Now, the Silk Route of the Sea, the episode which triggered it all was the Roman conquest of Egypt in 30 BC, which gave the Romans access to the Red Sea ports here, and the ports were refurbished, and through the Red Sea ports the access to most of the Indian Ocean lands, through the Gulf of Aden, the Persian Gulf, the East African coast, across the Arabian Sea to Western India, the southern part of India, the Gangetic Delta, Southeast Asia and into the South China Sea, which if not directly, then through several exchange networks which were interconnected. Now, in a sense, the trade which was triggered by the Romans, principally between Roman Egypt and India, was a major episode in world trade,
but it was a critical subset of the Silk Route of the Sea, which was a much more larger and complex construct. Now we have to distinguish the Silk Route of the Sea from the Silk Route of the Land, which began somewhere here from the Eastern Mediterranean and through Syria, Iraq, Iran, moved to the crossroads of Asia in Afghanistan. This is Bagram here, the ancient Kushan capital. And the routes then moved right into Central Asia, across into China, and down south through Taxila to the warm water ports of the Arabian Gulf, Sindh, and Western India, and across the Gangetic regions through the great sites and cities like Kaushambi to the ports on the Bay of Bengal. There were also routes which cut through the Indian Northeast into southern China and into Southeast Asia. So this is a larger construct of the Silk Routes, as the Silk Route of the Land and Silk Route of the Sea connected with each other. Now, the term Silk Route of the Sea is a term which has gained currency for several regions, but the point here is that it was not only silk that was traded along the Silk Route of the sea or land. There were far more numerous products, and silk was one of them. For instance, what we have here in South Arabia was the frankincense and myrrh, the aromatics, the tree resins, which were exported in large quantities to the Roman Empire and other parts of the world. In southern India, the botanical products, including pepper in large amounts, which was exported from the great ports of Muziris to the Roman Empire. In western India, it was semi-precious stone, cotton cloth, and also food which went to the arid places of Arabia and Eritrea. And of course, in the Gangetic zone, we had some of the finest muslins, the Himalayan herbs, and right into the Indian Northeast, there was also a great supply of malabathrum from this area. And of course, we have botanical products like cinnamon and cassia from the Southeast Asian region, craft products, great crafting of glass beads here in South India, also in Sri Lanka, which was exporting crafted products and botanical goods. Along the East African coast, a number of trade items which were being traded, especially, you know, forest products, and also, of course, the Persian Gulf, which was an active trading zone for long centuries before. So, we are going to take a journey from the Egyptian Red Sea route down the Red Sea across the Gulf of Aden to different points of the Indian Ocean lands in Persian Gulf, East Africa, India, Southeast Asia, and right up to the Far East. We begin our journey of the Silk Route of the Sea from the Egyptian Red Sea coast over here, and principally the ports of Myos Hormos here at Kusair al-Kadim and Berenike. These two harbors, which were refurbished by the Romans after their conquest of Egypt in 30 BC, actually were the main departure points of trade. And these two ports have been excavated. Myos Hormos has been excavated by American teams and later by the University of Southampton. And Berenike has been excavated for long years principally by Professor Stephen Sidebotham. And this has yielded rich evidence of trade with India, both import and export. Down the Red Sea, another important port we have here is Adulis on the Eritrean Sea coast. You know that Adulis was in the early centuries AD the port that gave access to the great kingdom of Axum on the Ethiopian highlands. And this was again a major point of trade with Western India. And here, as we go along, we will take the help of references to a sea guide called the Periplus Maris Erythrae, or the Periplus of the Erythraean Sea. This sea guide, dated to the 1st century AD, was compiled by an anonymous Greek sailor who sailed from the Egyptian Red Sea coast down the Red Sea to India in the time of the trade, and there are rich references to all these harbors, including Adulis, in which the Periplus says that Indian iron and steel was imported. And we do have finds from here of Indian material, and the Italian team from the Oriental Institute Naples, which has excavated Adulis, actually in recent times found a beautiful terracotta image dated to the Gupta period in their excavations. This is a fragment of a Roman amphora made in Italy and found in the harbor of Berenike. Interestingly, this carries an inscription in Tamil Brahmi, indicating or revealing that an Indian merchant from South India was resident at this port in Roman Egypt, and he owned this vessel. These are beautiful fragments of Roman glassware excavated at the Roman Egyptian port of Berenike by Professor Stephen Sidebotham of the University of Delaware. He also gave me the photograph of the Tamil inscribed amphora that you just saw. Now, these glassware pieces have been found all along the route of Egypt-India sea trade, as well as in the Persian Gulf and as far as Southeast Asia. Especially the one which is on the top right is a fragment of what we call a pillar molded bowl, which is fairly diagnostic find along the sea route. This is a piece of an Indian terracotta image of the Gupta period, dated to the 4th-5th century AD, found at the port of Adulis on the Eritrean Sea coast in the southern Red Sea, which the location of which I had pointed out to you earlier. And the port of Adulis was the gateway to the kingdom of Aksum on the Ethiopian highlands. And the Periplus informs us about the import of Indian goods like iron and steel into Adulis and to Aksum. This image was kindly supplied to me by Dr. Chiara Zazzaro of the University di Napoli La Orientale, which excavated at this site. Now, the route from the Egyptian Red Sea coast, maritime route coming down the Red Sea, and the ships transited through the narrow gap of the Bab el-Mandeb here and into the Gulf of Aden. And there were harbors on both shores of the Gulf, on the side of Saudi Arabia where Yemen and Oman. And we know that these are the regions which were producing some of the best aromatics, myrrh here and frankincense more towards, you know, the Omani side, the ancient kingdom of Hadramaut. And on the Somali side, there were a string of harbors like Alawites, Malau, Mundus, Musilum, the Spice Port and the Cape of Spices, which were trading in a lot of aromatics as well as other products. And there was also the island of Socotra, the ancient Sukhadipa, where interestingly in the year 2010, a major discovery was made deep within the limestone cave of Hawk, where as many as 200 Brahmi inscriptions dated from the 2nd to the 4th century AD were found, inscribed by Indian traders, Buddhist mendicants and the like, revealing that Indian counter trade to the Roman initiative was taking place, and the traders were reaching here. And interestingly, on the Yemen side, there have been excavations of the Periplus ports at Kana here, which is Bir Ali in Yemen, and also at Khor Rori, the ancient mosque of the Periplus. And I will show you a photograph of this place. View of the harbor of Khor Rori, the ancient mosque limen of the Periplus, which I just pointed out on the map. And in the background, you can see the Arabian Sea and the waters, you know, broken by the rocks, which are converging. And in the foreground are the structures which are actually storage structures for storing frankincense, which was exported from here to the Roman Empire and other parts of the Indian Ocean. And as I had informed you,
that this harbor has yielded a lot of Roman pottery, especially the amphora, Roman glass, and also a lot of Indian pottery, coins of the late Kushan period, the ruleted ware, and a bronze image of a dancing yakshi, which has unfortunately been lost. This is a photograph of the frankincense tree, which I got a chance to take when I visited the site of Khor Rori in 2011. This is the tree from which the resin is taken out from the bark, and this becomes the frankincense, which was exported in large quantities to Rome, burnt in front of the temples, emitting the very scented white smoke, which went up to the heavens, and that was called the food of the gods. Okay, now let's take a pause and see, you know, how far we have come. This is through the Bab el-Mandeb into the Gulf of Aden, which I just described, and the harbor of Khor Rori here. Now we will just go down the East African coast, which is also very important. The Periplus describes the last of the trading ports somewhere here at a place called Rafta, which is being investigated by colleagues in East Africa and the island of Zanzibar, and especially Professor Felix Chami in the Rufiji Delta, and other work on contacts along the East African coast being done by another colleague of mine, Dr. Jonathan Walls. So a number of ports have been excavated here, which are of course later than the period of the Periplus, which is the first century AD. There is Manda somewhere here and Kilwa down below. And of the period of the Periplus is this place at the edge, which is was known as Ras Hafun, and this was a Periplus port which was excavated by the British, and this has yielded a number of Roman wares and Indian pottery as well as Persian Gulf pottery. So this is a very interesting stretch of the coast from the point of view of the trade, which begins from the first century and continues through the 7th, 8th century and beyond. On the island of Zanzibar, which I had a chance to visit, I could visit the several port sites of a slightly later period than the Periplus. This is the beach facing site of Unguja Uku on the Zanzibar coast, facing the main Tanzanian mainland. And I had a chance to visit this in 2005. This site has been, you know, excavated by colleagues in East Africa and also Uppsala University. And there is an Indian connection to this. They have found red wares dated to the 6th, 7th century AD, which are similar to the late red polish wares from India. Let us go back to the South Arabian coast and continue our journey from the site of Khor Rori or ancient Moshka Liman and move along the sea route up towards the Persian Gulf. And the Persian Gulf, as I had stated earlier, was a segment of another great route of antiquity from the Mediterranean to the Indian Ocean lands, where the routes which began from the Eastern Mediterranean came down the river Euphrates to the head of the Persian Gulf, where you have the great harbor of Spesana or Charax, which is named in the Periplus. And the ships which are approaching the mouth of the Gulf, there are sites at the mouth of the Gulf which you can see. One is Ed Dur, the other is Dibba, the third one is Mlehia. So these form part of a harbor complex which is named in the Periplus, which is called the Harbor of Omana. One of these, or at least two or three of these together, would form a complex for Omana. And these sites have yielded a lot of Roman glass, Roman pottery, as well as a lot of Indian pottery.
And so we know that this trade in the first, second century AD was pretty thick over here. And then, you know, the segment, the route from the Persian Gulf, which went towards the Sindh coast and Western India, which we'll be talking about, and also connected the harbors of Khorrori and Kana. So these routes were pretty active. And also, it's pertinent to say that a lot of glassware, Mediterranean glassware, was moving down the Persian Gulf route, and some of it was moving ahead to places like Bagram. I'm going to show you a beautiful Roman goblet found in the Kushan capital of Bagram later. But there is also a kind of theory or modeling that perhaps some of the glass at Bagram was actually coming through the Persian Gulf route to the harbors of Sindh and taken overland to Taxila, Bagram, and then into Central Asia. This is a beautiful Roman glass goblet found at the site of Bagram in Afghanistan, which I just showed you. And know that this was the summer capital of the Kushan dynasty, and this is part of a larger cache of Roman glassware and other artifacts which were found at Bagram, which included, you know, a glassware which depicted the lighthouse of Alexandria and many other goblets. This particular one is showing, you know, the harvesting of dates from date palms, and is dated to the first century AD. This is a fragment of a painted jar which is dated to the 4th, 5th century AD and found at the site of Kamraj, which I'm going to show you, which I had a chance to excavate in 2003. And the interesting thing is that this is a fragment of pottery which has also been found at the coastal site of Mlaiya in the United Arab Emirates. This map shows part of the Sindh coast in Pakistan here, with the site of Banbore at the near the mouth of the Indus, and it shows the Saurashtra region of the Gujarat state of Western India, which was the ancient Cyrestrine of the Periplus, and of course part of the estuarine area of Gujarat in Western India, where you can see that the perennial river Narmada is flowing into the Gulf of Khambat, and just below that, the river Tapti, which is another perennial river, is also flowing into the same gulf. These two rivers have two important ports of antiquity which were situated at the estuary of these rivers. One is modern Bharuch, which was called Barigaza of the Greeks in the Periplus, or ancient Brigukach in the Sanskritic form. And below this is the site of Kamraj, modern Kamraj, which was named the village of Kamoni in the Periplus. These two sites, parts of the archaeological remains exist, more of Kamraj, and the Gulf of Khambat, which was very, very important for the sailors, is described in the Periplus. A number of sections in the Periplus are devoted to the trade ships from Egypt, which are sailing into this very violent gulf. They are encountering the shallows and high tides, and the entire vivid descriptions of the entry into the river Narmada. Now, these ports are very, very important from the point of view of the Silk Route trade, because it is at the ports on the Sindh coast. Banbore could possibly be Barbaricon, mentioned in the Periplus, which imported a lot of items and exported the famed Chinese silk, as well as you know, ceric animal skins, and a lot of material from Central Asia went out through this port. So also the port of Barigaza, which was considered one of the great ports of antiquity, rivaling the great Egyptian ports of Berenike and Myos Hormos. And we have vivid descriptions of this port in the Periplus. and I'm going to show you some photographs of these ports as we go along.
This is an archaeological mound formation which we came upon in course of our exploration in the modern settlement of Bharuch, which is the ancient Barigaza of the Periplus and the ancient Sanskritic port of Bhrigukach. This mound formation is very interesting. On the top of it are Islamic graves, but in the lower part, which you see a kind of band, that is where we found, you know, pottery dating to the 1st to 3rd, 2nd century AD, and it does represent archaeologically a part of the ancient port of Barigaza or Bhrigukach. This is a view of the ancient port site of Kamraj on the river Tapti. This is located something about 40-50 kilometers south of Bharuch, which is on the Narmada, and this is on the river Tapti, which you see in the foreground, and it's an estuarine site, which means that the sea is about 30 to 40 kilometers away. I got an opportunity under the supervision of the late Dr. S.P. Gupta of the Indian Archaeological Society to conduct excavations at this site, and we found evidence of iron working. We found pottery kilns with storage jars dating to the 1st to 3rd century AD, similar to the storage jars and cooking pots which have been found at the site of Khor Rori in Oman, at Kana in Yemen, and as far as the Egyptian Red Sea coast. Interestingly, we also found a fragment of a handle which has been identified as oxomite, which is that coming from, you know, the port of Adulis probably, and it is dated to the 4th, 5th century AD, which corroborates the information in the Periplus that Adulis in Eritrea was importing Indian iron and steel, and Kamraj was one of the ports which was in all likelihood supplying this material together with other, you know, commodities to the Arabian Peninsula.
So we have a little pause here and to see again the location of the sites. This is, as I just informed you, Bharuch on the Narmada, Kamraj, which I just described. And these are, of course, sites which are situated on the estuary of these rivers, and they are estuarine ports. But as you move down along the coast, this is the Konkan coast, and where Haigunda is and Udyavara is, this is the Kanara coast here, and of course down below that is the Malabar coast. Now the Konkan coast and the city of Mumbai is somewhere here, and the island of offshore island of Elephanta, which lies, you know, close to Mumbai. So these are mainly what could be described as creek based ports, where the seawater actually comes deep into the land, and where the creeks end, at the head of the creeks, are often, you know, the hills of the Western Ghats, which run parallel to the western coast, right up to the south of India, and often carved into these hills of the Western Ghats are Buddhist rock cut sanctuaries. So these are ports which have been listed in the Periplus. So we have Chol, which was similar of the Periplus, and we have Janjira, which could be identified at the head of the creek as the port of Mandagora. And a little later, in the little later period of 6th, 7th century AD, we had the important port of Elephanta. And then we moved down to the Kanara coast, and this is the ancient site of Haigunda, dated to the 4th century AD, and Udyavara. This stretch of the coast was called the Pirate Coast, especially in the Geographia of Ptolemy, dated to the 2nd century AD. But explorations around this coast have yielded rich archaeological evidence of sites which suggest that these were small trade ports that were flourishing in the period of the Silk Route.
This is a rim and handle fragment of a Red Sea amphora recovered from the island of Elephanta off the coast of the city of Mumbai. This amphora type, which is also known as the Akaba type, is dated to the 6th, 7th century AD, and that is the period when Elephanta was a great port of trade. It is a period slightly later than our core period, but this was the time of what we call the late Roman trade with the Red Sea, or the Byzantine Indian trade, and this type of amphora is fairly diagnostic. This is a view of the Janjira Creek, which I had pointed out in the map earlier, and this is the point where the creek actually ends. This is the head of the creek, and it is surrounded by the hills of the Western Ghats. And this photo has been taken by me from an early historic rock cut Buddhist sanctuary, which is called the Buddhist cave at Kuda. And down below is the village of Mandad, which recalls a port called Mandagora listed in the Periplus. This is the entrance to the early historic Buddhist rock cut cave of Bhaja. This is located at a strategic point on the Pune-Mumbai highway, on the ancient trade route which came down from the Deccan Highlands down to the Konkan coast, where, you know, the creek-based ports which I showed you in Janjira are located. And these early historic Buddhist sanctuaries are found also along the coast at Kanheri near Mumbai, at Chawl, and the one at Kuda, which is overlooking the Janjira Creek, which I showed you. And these caves often had donative inscriptions by traders and caravan leaders who donated to the carving of these caves, the upkeep of these caves. And this particular cave at Bhaja is one of the earliest, dated to the 2nd century BC. Cave of Bhaja is part of a complex of cave groups located at this point of the Pune-Mumbai highway, which includes the well-known Buddhist cave of Karla and that of Bedsa. Now we come to the Kanara coast, which is situated south of the Konkan coast, which we just discussed and showed you the pictures of the early Buddhist rock cut caves there. This is 300 kilometers of beautiful coastline stretching from Karwar right up to the river Netravali in the South Kanara region. This stretch of the coastline which you see is the location here on the map of Peninsula India on the Arabian Sea, was called the Pirate Coast by Ptolemy, the geographer Ptolemy, in his Geographia dated to the 2nd century AD. With the result that all the historians who then wrote about the coast just blindly followed the description of the Geographia, that it was a pirate coast, and did not really take it into consideration in history writing, effectively wiping out this very critical stretch of the coastline from any history of the Silk Route, except for the fact that it was peopled by pirates. And these are, of course, this is Malpe over here, Udyavara, which is Udyavara is an ancient settlement at the head of the creek. And this place, Malpe, is associated with conflicts between Greek sailors and local chieftain, and whom the Greeks called pirates. They may not have been necessarily so. These were small harbors, and we come to this place, which is Haigunda, a riverine island here, which is in the middle of the river Sharavati. And I will show you a photo of a beautiful Yaksha figure which wasn't found here. So the exploration which I carried out with my colleague Shiva Aruni in 2001 from almost Karwar right up to Udyavara showed a number of sites which seem to be well-settled settlements, and they may have been trading with Western shipping coming from Egypt. The
debate is that these small chieftains may have been competing for the larger fruits of trade and therefore may have been forcing trade ships to come into the harbor to trade in a variety of very rich forest products, because this is an area which, you know, yields a lot of pepper, a lot of forest produce, a lot of, you know, semi-precious stone as well. So this is an important part of, you know, the Silk Route trade, which had gone missing, but I think archaeology has resurrected it.
This is a large size figure of a yaksh in stone, which we chanced upon on Haigunda Island in the middle of the river Sharavati on the Kanara coast. This yaksh, as you know, are semi-divine entities which were tasked to do superhuman work. And this figure, which is over 6 feet tall, is dated to the 4th century AD. It has the characteristics of the Indian Gupta art, as well as influences of Gandhara and also some Mediterranean influences, which shows that this actually is a sculpture which has been created through diverse influences, and therefore indicates that this part of the coast was visited by traders and merchants, and it's a well-settled coast full of forest produce, full of semi-precious stone, and this is the coast which had a lot to offer, and there was no reason to indicate that this was arid or lacking in resources and therefore a breeding ground for piracy.
Okay, we have reached quite far in our journey, but we are still on the western coast of India. We have covered the Konkan coast here and the Kanara coast, and then south of the Kanara coast, right up to the tip of Peninsula India, is the Malabar coast. And this is a site here called Patanam, which has been identified with a great anthropoid in the time of the Periplus called Musiris, or Mukiri in Tamil. And this port is celebrated in Greek literature, especially in the Periplus, as a great center of trade between the Roman Empire and India. This was, Patanam was the principal port. Musiris was the principal port which exported pepper and also other products like Malabathram, which came from the Indian Northeast. And then we will speak about Arikamedu on the Bay of Bengal, which was excavated by Mortimer Wheeler in 1945. The first Indo-Roman trading station to have been discovered with the excavation of the Roman amphorae and other Roman potteries. And then, of course, Sri Lanka here, which has the great Iron Age cities of Anuradhapura in the north and Tissamaharama in the south, the port of Mantai, which rivaled Musiris and Arikamedu, and Godavaya, the offshore of which a 2nd century BC shipwreck has been found, which contained beautiful glass ingots, which probably were made in the Indian subcontinent itself. So this is a very, very active part of the Silk Route of the sea, where the Roman impact was felt, but also independently, the ports on the eastern coast, especially right up till the Andhra coast here in Bengal, were trading independently with Southeast Asia from as early as the 4th century BC, which means several centuries before the Roman impact. But the two exchange networks came together somewhere over here. And of course, we have the integration of the Silk Route taking place right up to Southeast Asia and even beyond to Japan, which we will be speaking about.
This is one of the sites at the village of Patanam on the Malabar coast, which was subjected to excavation by the Kerala Council of Historical Research under the supervision of Professor Cherian, whom you can see in this photograph in the blue shirt somewhere in the middle. And I am located just behind him, and beside him is Roberta Tomber, expert from the British Museum and a colleague on Indo-Roman trade.
On the towards the right, you can see Professor Stephen Sidebottom, who's got a camera hanging on his neck. He is the excavator of the Roman Egyptian port of Berenike, and other colleagues as well. This is one of the sites of Pattanam, which was subjected to excavations and which has been identified, the entire complex there, as at least part of the greater port of Musiris, which is mentioned in the Periplus. Now we cross over to the Coromandel coast on the Bay of Bengal side, and this is the site of Arikamedu, which I had shown you. I shown you its location on the map, and this is the Indo-Roman trading station which Mortimer Wheeler excavated in 1945 and found that uninterrupted amphora sequence which we talked about, as well as Roman pottery and a lot of glassware and glassworking. And the site is actually the bank, that is the cultural deposits beside the river Ariyamkuppam, which flows just 2-3 kilometers away, is the Bay of Bengal. You can see the catamarans in the middle of the river, and you walk along the sides of the river, you can see the early historic pottery and other structures sticking out from the sections. Now, we had talked about the glass trade and the syncretic glass technologies which emerged in the Silk Route of the Sea. This is glassware from the surface of Arikamedu, and which was a major site for making Indo-Pacific style glass beads, which I'll show you. But at the same time, it was a center where Mediterranean and Indian glass crafting technologies came together in amazing ways. On the top left, you can see that is part of a glass, and you can see this perforation which was sought to be made, and they were attempting to actually make a faceted glass in the shape of a barrel. In the top middle is a piece of glass with the red and black striations which attempts to imitate the red agate or sardonyx. On the top right is a piece of cobalt blue glass debitage, which is typical of import of Roman glassware from the Mediterranean. You get exactly the same type of cobalt blue glasses, raw glasses, at the Egyptian Red Sea coast, particularly at Berenike, and some have also been found in Southeast Asia. At the bottom, the two red or reddish glasses are most probably fragments of Roman glassware, which was imported into Arikamedu.
Now we are in the heart of the Eastern Indian Ocean. And we've talked about Sri Lanka and the location of the site of Arikamedu. This is a construct of routes that I've made in the Eastern Indian Ocean, which I call the Cowrie Trail. These routes, which come from the area of Musiris and go through Arikamedu along the east coast and up the Gangetic Delta into the Indian Northeast, crossing over into southern China and coming down Southeast Asia towards Thailand and other parts of Southeast Asia, were active segments of the Silk Route of the Sea. The principal items that were exchanged along this route were large amounts of glass beads from South India, perhaps also from the Gangetic zone, which were transmitted through the sea land routes into the Indian Northeast in exchange for certain botanical products, principally Malabathrum. And interestingly, the last passages of the Periplus end here, where it gives vivid account of tribals exchanging Malabathrum for trade goods, and also referring to a place called Thina, which could be anywhere between Northeast India and Southern China. And then there were the routes which went down into Southeast Asia towards sites in Central Thailand and below, and I will show you evidence of that.
Now, I spoke about early Indic beads reaching Southeast Asia. These are stone and glass beads found at the site of Bandon Taphet in Central Thailand, and these are dated to the 4th century BC, and this site was excavated by the late Ian Glover, And on the top, you see the etched agate beads. And in the middle is a faceted glass pendant, which was created in all likelihood to imitate, you know, stones like beryl. And at the bottom are carnelian barrel-shaped beads, very similar, almost exact, to those that you get in the Gangetic Valley in the same period. These are small monochrome drawn glass beads, which are probably not more than 3 or 4 millimeters in diameter. And these were made in large numbers in South India, particularly at the site of Arikamedu, and also in several sites in Southeast Asia. They have been found in India and Southeast Asia as early as the 5th century BC, though we still do not have production sites discovered as early as that. The production sites discovered are closer to the 1st century BC. And interestingly, these particular beads, the photograph here, are these Indo-Pacific beads. We call these the Indo-Pacific monochrome drawn glass beads, which have been discovered in Yayoi period graves of the 1st, 2nd century AD in Japan. And this was my research, which I had a chance to do as a postdoctoral fellow in 1988-99. This is the first ever distribution map of Indo-Pacific beads from the Bay of Bengal area, found in Yayoi period graves of the 1st, 2nd century AD in Japan. This was part of my postdoctoral research work under Professor Yoshinori Yasuda of Nichibunken Institute, and in collaboration with Dr. Oga Katsuhiko of the Nara Institute. And these are about more than 150 Yayoi graves, and some of them yield, if not hundreds, then thousands of Indo-Pacific beads, which indicate the intensity and surge of imports of these beads into Japan as early as the 1st, 2nd century AD from the Silk Route Exchange networks of the Eastern Indian Ocean. Similarly, South Korea also yields, you know, hundreds of sites of the Indo-Pacific beads. So we can imagine that this is the, you know, final outlier of the Silk Route of the sea, and how far the trade and the exchange networks went. Equally interesting is the fact that the importation of these beads into Japan occurs in the 1st century AD, exactly at the same time when Roman trade impacts India in a big way.
In the end, we come back to our map of the entire arena of the Silk Route of the sea. It's been a journey which started from the Egyptian Red Sea coast, the Roman harbors, down the Red Sea to these harbors and anchorages on the Gulf of Aden, East Africa, into the Persian Gulf, the alternative sea routes, the land routes which are reaching Bagram and going into Central Asia. We talked about the possibility of glass going from the warm water ports into Bagram and into Central Asia. And of course, the great ports of Bharuj and Kamrej on the western coast, the creek-based ports on the Konkan, on the Kanara, the pirate coast, the Malabar coast, Arikamedu, the Eastern Indian coast, and of course the Kauri Trail, Southeast Asia, the exchange networks going right up to Japan and Korea, in southern China as well, where we get a good distribution of Indo-Pacific beads and also Roman glass and Persian glass. So, and Sri Lanka, which is no less important, as we describe the cities of Anuradhapura, Tissamahārāma, East Africa, where, you know, colleagues are doing a fantastic job of searching for the last port on the African coast, trade port from Egypt, Egyptian sailors which were reaching this port called Rafta. So this is the arena of the Silk Route of the sea, which is a fascinating episode in world history, a time when, in my opinion, the world reached closest to what we call globalization. So I hope that I've been able to hold your patience for so long, and thank you very much.